Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Prisoner and Yet by Corrie Ten Boom, narrated by Clare Staniforth. Prelude. Daddy, do you know you haven't tucked me in? What a weight of reproach there can be in the voice of a child. Yes, dear, I'm coming. The doctor with whom I was conversing excused himself. We both understood that being tucked in was of much greater importance than any economic problems we might be discussing. He went upstairs, and I heard the slight sounds of a minute's romping, the chatter of two child voices, and then the footsteps of the doctor as he returned down the stairs. We went on with our conversation, but my mind was no longer really on the subject. The doctor and his wife were Jews. The Gestapo might arrive at any moment to snatch those children from their beds and drag them off to some camp for a sudden or lingering death. Would the father be taken away from his family and the mother mourn for her children in faraway Poland? Daddy, do you know that you haven't tucked me in? A resolution took form in my heart. I shall help the Jews wherever I can. Introduction. How can I write a foreword to a book like this? I am taken out of my depth, both in the horrors endured and in the tender compassion of Christ which shines through all the scenes. Man is a dreadful, demonic being in the deeps of his fallen nature, not by any means only the terrible fellow humans we meet in this book, but all humanity. Did we but really see ourselves as God knows us to be, shorn of the moral influences and civilizing refinements which sustain us? I have often wondered at the drastic descriptions of the sheer wickedness, malice, and degradation of man, both in heart and act, so constantly presented to us as the true facts of our natures in the Scriptures. My knowledge of myself, or the little I really know of myself, but for the grace of God, bears these out. But I have had a job to believe this is really so of all my neighbours without that same grace. But it is, and this record drives it home to me with appalling force. These were not primitive savages or so-called heathen, but members of a so-called Christian nation. Let us beware and learn, for all are alike in their basic nature, yes, each of us listeners. And prophecies such as the Book of Revelation give us fair warning of the horrible harvest of evil and suffering proceeding out of the evil heart of Satan and man, which is the destiny of this world, till its rightful king returns in person. Let us be sure that we have personally found the only change of our nature possible through the personal acceptance of the only Saviour. That transforming miracle is what radiates through this otherwise terrible book. We see not Satan triumphant, nor hardened and wicked men and women, but the compassionate conquering Christ. How marvellous to see the rest, the sweetness, the joy he actually gives, and gives continually to one in months of solitary confinement, and equally in months of crowded conditions, with never one hour alone, in filth, vermin, stench, starvation, cold, rough toil, amid curses, the whip, and hours of weansome standing and shivering on parades. And more wonderful still, how he lifts the one in whom he lives above herself and immerses her in the dreadful sufferings of those around her. An angel in hell, but no, much more than an angel, the Christ of the cross living again, his own beautiful life of pity and power among the tormented. None could really write these things but one who had experienced them, for this is no highly polished reporter's story. Christ-filled Christians are still humans. They suffer and question and shrink, even as they follow. Out of weakness they are made strong. And in Corrie Ten Boom, again we hear the human cry of the great sufferer in his darkest hour. If it be possible, let this cup pass from me. but also those words of triumph which took him through his cross. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. Matthew chapter 26, verse 39. Yes, this is a book of triumph through Christ, a triumph transmitted to many other in those awful places of torment. And it cannot but put faith and hope into the heart of any listener who, knowing himself, is tempted to wonder if he too can endure his appointed cross. He too will say to himself, "Yes, I can," by Corrie's Christ. N.P. Grubb, London. Chapter 1. The House in Bartoljorestraat. Life in the Underground. The music of one of Tartini's sonatas filled the drawing room of our home in Bartoljorestraat. All around were people in listening attitudes, concentrating on the music. The violinist was a young lawyer who had been forced underground and was now a guest in our home because he had become depressed in his previous environment. For our home, it was often said, was the gayest underground address in all the Netherlands. And indeed, there was harmony and happiness here, though not unmixed with care or undisturbed by threats of grave danger. Yussi was to sing a song for us next. There was a moment of absolute silence as the last tender note of the violin sonata died away. But the stillness was suddenly broken by the distant rumble of anti-aircraft guns and the joyless singing of German soldiers in the street. Then Yussi stood at the piano. He was a cantor and had a beautiful voice. Passionately he sang his Jewish song, pouring out the longing, the grief, and the indignation of his race. He was, for the moment, an interpreter of the age-old anguish of Israel. But he was singing too loudly, and I had to warn him, "Yussi, they will hear you out in the street, and everyone will know there is a Jew in the house. You must sing more softly, or stop singing altogether." I was sorry to put an end to it all, but Yussi was like an overgrown boy. He could not realize how completely Jewish he was in person and manner, nor understand that that very fact meant danger to himself and to those about him. The atmosphere had suddenly become strained. When, oh when, would this menace pass and we again be permitted to enjoy freely the good things in life? I went to the piano and started playing, and a quartet took up the melody. "Come now with song of melody sweet, rejoicing with stringed instrument." There were both trained and untrained voices among the singers, but their voices blended in perfect harmony. We were once more completely engrossed in our music when I was called away. Downstairs in the hall, like frightened animals escaping the chase, stood a Jewish couple, pleading for shelter. I took them into the dining room and gave them some hot coffee. The man's hands were trembling so that he could hardly hold the cup, and he spilled the coffee. His teeth were chattering, and he began a confused tale of all the wealth they had had to leave behind. A beautiful leather travelling bag, linens, provisions, and magnificent oriental rugs. They had been safely under cover, but that night a warning had come. They had been betrayed, and the SD were already on the way to seize them. "Of course you are welcome to stay here for the night, and then we shall see. We'll take care of you. Try not to be frightened, for everything will come out all right." I left them downstairs with Father, who knew so well how to comfort people, and he loved the Jews. Our family had always loved Jehovah's Covenant people, even in previous generations. Upstairs, our refugee guests and I talked things over. Hans, the student, could sleep in the angel crib, as we called our hidden closet behind a blind wall. There was a grilled vent in it to admit fresh air, and we could leave the sliding door open. Then the Jewish woman could have Hans's little room, and her husband could sleep with the boys. But 9 refugees were too many for our small house, so Peter went out at once to look for another underground address. When he returned at almost 10, he had still found nothing. The first house was filled. In the second were children who could not be depended upon to keep quiet about Jewish guests. Another had Dutch Nazi neighbours. And so as we prayed that evening, there were two more burdens to cast upon the Lord. Early the next morning, the stream of co-workers in the underground began to pour in. I asked each one, "Do you know of a place for a Jewish couple?" Fred knew of an opening for the day after tomorrow, and I hurried off to tell Tante Mien, which was the new name we had given our latest arrival. She was in the kitchen peeling potatoes with Yussi and the other boys. Hank, the violinist, was telling jokes, and they were having a jolly time. How different from the first days that Hank had been with us. Then he would sit for hours, silently staring into space. Later, he revealed himself to be a young fellow who, though quiet, was also full of fun and capable of arousing the gales of laughter I now heard in the kitchen. Oom Jan, the second new guest, was sitting beside Father smoking his pipe. When I informed them there would be a place for them in a day or two, both he and his wife begged to be allowed to stay with us here, but that was impossible. Leaving it to my sister, Betsy, she was 7 years older than I, to convince them, I hurried upstairs, where many people were waiting for my attention. "Do you have a place for a Jewish child? How do I procure a green Ausweis?" One boy had come all the way from Limburg. With other boys and girls, he worked in an organization which cared for hundreds of Jewish children. One of the girls had with her 8 psychopathic cases, boys and girls of all ages. The problem of their care seemed to have reached an impasse. "Is there some psychiatrist you can consult? Good. Ask him to make up a report on them, and I shall see that they are placed in the proper institutions." What a busy day. The problems piled up. A Jewish woman was about to give birth. I myself would have to find time to confer with the hospital authorities. Somewhere a child had contracted diphtheria. A man had died and I had to arrange for a clandestine burial. That day I dispatched couriers to Limburg, Friesland and Enschede. My room resembled a beehive. It was indeed a sort of clearing house for supply and demand. I met the needs of one with help provided by another. "You know a place for a child? Fine, make arrangements with Marie over there. She has an emergency case. She has also asked for Ausweisen. Dick, you know what to do about that. 20 more ration cards. Right, you shall have them. Jim, fetch 25 cards out of the stair cubbyhole. Mies will soon be here for 5 more." The stair cubbyhole was one of our hidden storage places inside the top step of the staircase. No one would ever suspect that there was a cupboard there. In a small shed on the public tennis courts, a man was lying, seriously ill. He had been there when his host was arrested. He himself barely escaped. That evening, people would be playing on the courts, and the man had to be removed before 6. The courts were beyond Sandpoort. "All right, boys, let's get busy. Who will arrange for transportation? Who for an address?" My fine, capable boys jumped up and talked things over. In a few minutes, there was silence as each one of them slipped out on his errand. What attractive young people they were. Such fresh, strong faces. There were some resolute characters among these boys and girls. They were serious for their age and were doing independent, responsible work. Human lives depended on their faithfulness and no less on their ability to maintain silence. They felt at home with me. If they were too busy to go home, which was not infrequent, they ate and slept in the Beje. Beje was the pseudonym for Bartel Jorestraat. Occasionally there was time for a chat about their own difficulties and troubles, and then they would confide in me the secrets which were far more characteristic of their age than the problems with which they were occupied throughout most of the day. Not until 10 o'clock that evening did I find time to get my records in shape. I had missed the class in Italian. Mary, our eldest refugee, who formerly conducted a travel bureau in Italy, was teaching it. Yussi taught Hebrew, Hans astronomy. Jim felt he could not compete with all these scholars. He could, however, give an evening's programme of magic. His tricks were a bit obvious, but they provided us with a diversion and created a cheerful atmosphere. Everyone attended the class in Italian. Even Father came with his notebook. His 84 years did not keep him from broadening his knowledge of languages, for language study was one of his hobbies. It was great fun to have so many people in the house. We sat at the oval table in the dining room with our chairs a bit aslant, for that was the only way we could all get around it. We sat so close together that the cat, deservedly and elaborately named Mahashalal Hashbaz, which means hastening to the spoil, hurrying to the prey, had devised a little game of walking about from one shoulder to another until he came to rest on Grandfather's. Our spirits were a bit uproarious that day. How different was our house from what it appeared to be to the outside world, the home of three more or less old people. Suddenly, a ladder was placed against the window, and the faces about the table tightened, especially those of our latest guests. They turned pale with fright. Fortunately, it was only the window cleaner come to wash the windows. What a relief! But still, suppose the man should be a traitor. How could we explain the presence of so many people in our house? Yussi had an idea. We'll pretend it's Aunt Bessie's birthday and sing the traditional song, Happy Birthday to You. Deep basses, altos and sopranos all tried to sing along, but laughter kept us from finishing the beautiful song. Yussi, go and sit with your back to the window.
That will do no good, said Hans. Even his neck is Semitic.
Can this always go on this way? I wondered. I had a small Bible tucked away in my clothes and a pencil hidden in my hair. Someday, I felt certain, things would go wrong. The number of our co-workers increased by the day. We had already sheltered more than 80 refugees in the Bege for varying periods of time, though our guests had never been fewer than 7 or more than 12 in number at one time. One small nucleus always remained. Yussi, Mary, and later Martha were Jews. Then there were Peter and Hans, who were students, and Leonard, a teacher. The latter were refugees who worked with the underground, and all of them helped with the household tasks. The house was becoming a bit untidy, for there was no really expert help to be had, but we did the best we could. The most important thing in any case was that people should be rescued, and next that they should have a happy home, and repeated scoldings about tidiness did not fit into that picture. Things that were formerly so important were now relegated to the background. Safety measures were tremendously important. Consequently, we practiced safety drills. After everyone had gone to bed, I would press one of the alarm bells that had been installed throughout the house. With a stopwatch in hand, I would stand by while everyone disappeared into my closet. Under the bottom shelf was a sliding door, behind which was the secret space where approximately 8 people could stand. On the floor of this hiding place was a mattress, a supply of Victoria water, and some Sanovit. Every night before retiring, all of our guests in transit would bring their outer and underclothing into the angel crib. It was a comic sight. Yussi's braces always trailed along after him as he carried in his clothes. One of the boys would go inside and hang all the clothing on a hall stand. In our drills, however, they themselves would also disappear. They ducked down and vanished under the shelf. The last I saw of them was their legs. Then they would place boxes and laundry on the floor of the closet and shove down the sliding door. 70 seconds it took them. I made the rounds of the rooms. They looked uninhabited, the mattresses turned over, the blankets folded underneath, the sheets were taken along into hiding. Yussi had left some cigar ashes and Hans a collar stud. From the angel crib I could hear Yussi's very Jewish voice.
Mary, you're blowing on my neck.
I called them out and everyone sat on the floor in front of my bed as we cheerfully talked over the drill. Yussi's ashes, the collar stud and the noisy remark were all discussed. It was a pity that we had to have these drills.
We all felt keenly the tragic necessity of them, and so I used to ease the situation by treating the group to cream puffs. They all knew that this was the customary conclusion to our drills, and Yussi would often say, "Aren't we going to have an alarm tonight? I'm hungry for cream puffs." Enemy raid. On February 28, 1944, came the actual alarm. I was lying abed with influenza and had a vaporizer burning to relieve my congested bronchia. Past the bed raced four Jewish refugees, followed into the hiding place by two underground workers, who were also in great danger because they were carrying incriminating papers on their persons. I threw my briefcase of records in after them, placed the boxes in front of the opening, and closed the closet door. I was just back in my bed when I heard heavy footsteps on the stairs. A surly-looking man entered my room.
"Who are you? Give me your identification card."
Out of a small bag, I drew my identification card. A packet of banknotes came out with it. The man seized it greedily and thrust it into his pocket, looked at my identification card and said,
"Get up at once. You're my prisoner."
As I dressed, I could hear other men walking through the house and the sound of hammer blows against a door.
"Where is your secret room?" demanded the man.
"I won't tell you."
"Oh, yes, you will. But of course that is where your Jews are hidden. Never mind. I'll have the house watched until they've turned into mummies."
A fiendish smile played about his cruel mouth. Coming downstairs, I found the dining room filled with people. My brother had just conducted a Bible study group, which had been well attended. And now everyone who crossed our threshold was arrested. The Berge had become a Gestapo trap. The captain who was in charge of the raid, a man with a pale, cruel face, ordered me to accompany him to my shop.
"Take off your glasses," he snarled.
Then began my interrogation. After every question, he gave me a slap in the face. I grew dizzy after the first blow. For a minute, I had a severe pain, which did, however, subside fairly soon. But as he continued slapping me, I began to fear that I would not be able to endure it. "Lord Jesus, protect me," I cried aloud. A horrible expression crept over his cruel face. He hissed at me.
"If you mention that name once more, I shall kill you."
But he stopped beating me. Then Betsy was brought in, and I was sent back to the dining room. But I was not given a chance to pick up my glasses, and had to do without them for weeks. When Betsy returned, my other sister asked, "Were you beaten?" "Yes," said Betsy, "and I do so pity the man who beat me." When the captain had continued striking her also, she called out, "Oh, Saviour, Saviour!" He shouted at her,
"Silence! Don't use that name!"
But again he stopped abruptly. The entire house was searched. A closet in the dining room, which we had not considered safe as a hiding place for people, but where we had hidden many valuables, was discovered. Out of it came a large number of silver Reichsdalders we had saved. They were thrown on the table and then vanished into the captain's pouch. Boxes of watches belonging to Jews and other knick-knacks followed. Meanwhile, all of those who had fallen into the Nazi trap were sitting or standing along the walls. No one said a word, and there was something ominous about the silence. My father was very calm as he sat in his chair beside the fire. I started to go to him, but one of the Gestapo turned my chair about and made me sit facing the wall. I no longer had anything to say in my own home. Was there anger in my heart because of this humiliating treatment? No. Only concern for all the people about me. "Oh dear," I thought, "there comes missionary Lasschewit. He too will fall into the trap and be arrested." An old woman was babbling unsuspectingly to one of the Gestapo in the hall. "Mynheer, I have come to report that Uncle Herman has been seized. The folk here had better look out too. Will you tell them for me that they must be careful?"
"Yes, indeed," replied the Gestapo man with a feline sweetness. "Whom, for instance, should I warn?"
Oh, I don't know, just all those people who come to this house.
Then the telephone rang. I had been a bit proud of having kept that telephone a secret and of having been able to help many people make clandestine telephone connections by my intervention. But now I heard it with fear and dismay. I was compelled to take the calls, with one of the Gestapo men beside me listening in. I tried as much as possible to indicate by my voice that something was very wrong here. Over and over I heard the same message. Do you know that Uncle Herman has been apprehended? Do be careful. You too are in danger. If only I dared to shout into the phone. Yes, I know. We also have been arrested and one of the Gestapo men is standing here beside me, listening to our conversation. But I did not dare. I had respect for the hand of that human beast in my hall. Then one of the men tried to put in a call, but got no response. The clandestine connection was broken. They had understood my unspoken thought. The captain was furious. How does it happen that the connection is broken? Do you have a secret number? Innocently, I answered. I know nothing about it. I don't understand what has happened. But secretly, I was greatly relieved. There would be no more telephone calls. People knew our misfortune. And now I was, after all, sitting beside Father and trying to stir the fire. Betsy was serving bread. I could scarcely get it down, but observed that our servant accepted it hungrily. Poor man! How wretched for him to have been arrested also! His wife and children would be so distressed! As my glance met Betsy's, she pointed to our lovely new fireplace. There, against the tiles, hung a simple pokerwork plaque which read, "Jesus is Victor." Father followed the direction of my glance and said aloud,
"Yes, indeed, that is absolutely true."
There seemed to be a visible relaxation in the faces of those around us now that someone had broken the silence. Or was it, perhaps, because they too had read the text? "It looks now," I mused, "as if the Gestapo were the conquerors, but they are not. I do not understand it all, but believing is not the same as understanding." Suddenly one of the Gestapo said to Father,
"I see a Bible over there. Tell me, what does it say about the government?"
And Father answered, "Fear God, honour the Queen."
"That is not true. The Bible doesn't say that."
"No, it says, fear God and honour the King. But in our case, that is the Queen." The cat jumped up on my lap and rubbed her soft fur against me. It touched me so. What would become of her pretty soon after the house was empty? I was almost thankful when we started out for the police station in the Smierestraat. Father leaned heavily on my arm. Passing the Frisian clock in the hall, he suggested that I pull up the weights. Didn't he realise that tomorrow he would no longer be here in this house with his beloved clock? During all this time, our six refugees and co-workers were safely hidden in our secret chamber. The Gestapo knew they were there, but could not locate the room. Our house was so old and so curiously constructed that no one could see that in one room there were two stone walls, between which there was space enough for eight persons. A guard of two policemen was left to watch the house. After 2.5 days, policemen who were sympathetic to the underground were on duty. They had been informed of the plight of the poor prisoners by our co-workers, and as soon as it was safe, released them. How thankful they were to escape from their cramped quarters. Not until dark did they dare to venture out into the street. Yussi was so happy to be outside that he raised his arms in the middle of the street and chanted a Jewish prayer. Would the boy never be sensible? At the police station, a large mattress was placed on the floor for our sleeping accommodation. I counted 35 prisoners. All of Father's children, 3 daughters, 1 son and 1 grandson, shared the mattress with him.
"I once saw this in a dream," said Betsy.
I didn't understand what it meant, but I saw father and all of his children and many others lying on a mattress. Before we lay down, father gathered us all about him. At his request, my brother read Psalm 91, and then father prayed. How often in the past I had heard my father praying, and his voice, even now, was as calm and tranquil as ever before. This was the last time that he was to pray with us, although I did not realize it then. A policeman was sitting in the room on guard. He was friendly, and as he looked at father, I could see an expression of sadness come into his eyes. "He is very likely the oldest prisoner you have ever had to guard, isn't he?" I asked.
"Things are bad enough," he grumbled in reply.
Since we had been left almost entirely to ourselves, we had an excellent opportunity to plan together, quietly, what answers we should give in case we were brought to trial. How should we explain all of those people coming to our house? But we were warned to be on our guard, and just in time. A certain watchmaker, a colleague of my father, had ostensibly been arrested with us. He was really a provocateur. As we talked together, he came and stood behind us. Leaving Harlem. The day that followed upon that sleepless night was long and tedious. We could not expect pleasant events, yet we longed for something to happen. Once we are in our prison cells, we told one another, we shall be able to rest. At noon, a large bus stopped at the station. As we stepped into it, we saw many fellow citizens standing about. Everyone was quiet. Harlem loved my father. Harlem's grand old man was its favourite name for him. And now his friends and neighbours were standing in the street, most of them with tears in their eyes. The Grote Markt looked so beautiful. The sun was shining down on the Grote Kerk. It was a radiant February day, and one could already feel something of spring in the air. Harlem's last greeting was a bright and sunny one. When would I see it again? "Just think, Father, when we next see Harlem, it will be free." "No," said Betsy, "you will see it before then." I had my arm around my father, and he leaned heavily against me. He was very weak, and we spoke only about heaven. "The best is yet to come," had always been one of Father's favourite expressions. "Whatever comes to pass, heaven awaits us," we reminded him. "That is certainly true," said Father. He was neither restless nor sad. It occurred to me that he did not quite realise where he was going. In my heart was a great sense of peace. I had long expected this catastrophe. Now the blow had fallen. I accepted it as the close of an exciting chapter of my life. In my mind, I kept telling myself, "Don't ever feel sorry for yourself." Chapter 2. In prison at Scheveningen. Father's last days. In Scheveningen, we were brought to the bureau of the Gestapo. My sister said to the officers, "My father is so ill and weak, he will not be able to take that high step into the auto."
"Don't worry, mevrouw," was the answer. "We shall carry him."
And they did carry him, carefully. In the car, father leaned back, his mouth fell open, and then it occurred to me for the first time that he might never return. As father was carried into the bureau, a German said,
"You might as well let that man die at home."
"What?" yelled the captain.
"That man is the worst of them all. He talks about nothing but Jesus and the Queen."
It was still quite a distance from the bureau to the prison, and we were shoved into a patrol car. It reminded me of the tumbrils in the stories of the French Revolution. It was a horrible vehicle, without springs, and jolted continually. Father lay in my arms. Even one of the officers helped to support him to ease the worst jolts. And then the gate of the great prison closed behind us. "Alle Nasen gegen Mauer," every nose to the wall, and there we stood facing the wall. Father was allowed to sit on a chair. I pressed a kiss on his forehead. that noble forehead. "The Lord be with you," I whispered. "And with you," was his reply. I turned and looked back once more. It was my last glimpse of Father on earth. He was to survive his arrest by only 10 days. In the cell, he was reported to have been very courageous, saying to his cellmates, "If I am released tomorrow, I shall go on the day after tomorrow giving aid to the Jews and shelter and help to all who need it." Long afterwards, I learned that during his last days, his mind was confused. He was brought to a hospital, where he died in the corridor. They buried him in a pauper's grave. The date was March 9, 1944. When he died, his children and youngest grandson were in the same prison. What little effort it would have required to bring us to him. But we were not allowed even to know that he had died. A nephew at home read the death notice in the paper on the very day that two of Father's grandchildren had gone to The Hague to pick up whatever information they could about their grandfather's condition. They were sent from pillar to post and were finally told in some office, "Oh, your grandfather was buried yesterday." On the label of a package sent to Betsy, a niece wrote, "Do not grieve about grandfather. He has gone where no one can do him any more harm, and where he always longed so much to go. The best is yet to come," was his motto, and now the best has come for him. Keep courage, Auntie. It is the best way. People had often warned Father, "If you persist in harbouring so many Jews, you will eventually end in prison, and in your delicate condition, you could never survive that." And Father would answer, "If that should come to pass, I shall consider it an honour to give my life for God's ancient people." That honour had now been bestowed upon him. Father had died in prison, a martyr's death. When Betsy heard about it, she wrote home, "Anyone who lived so close to the Saviour, to whom spiritual things were so real, and who had in such a glorious measure the gift of prayer, such a person has all the prerequisites for martyrdom. I have always thought he will never die in his bed." God had not permitted the reins of government to slip from his fingers. In my cell. I was thrust into a cell. Lying on the floor were four persons, among whom were a young baroness and an Austrian charwoman from the Wehrmacht. They welcomed me kindly. "I'm sorry that I must share your very limited space," I said politely. They showed me a wooden cot against the wall and gave me some bread and water. I was literally famished. After eating, I stretched out on the hard, uneven mattress and in a very short time fell asleep. In the morning, I was awakened by the opening of the sliding bolt of the cell door. It sounded as if someone were giving.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.